And I think if we break some of these layers of rock open, we'll find some fish.
I'm hoping that happens. Yeah.
So what we're gonna do is go in right along a seam right in here, and you can see how this whole thing is
lifting up here.
Yeah, it's a big slab. And just kind of get your fingers underneath there and lift it up. And so now what we're gonna do is we're gonna take some of these chisels. Yeah, we're gonna split down through this.
Going down on it
and see what we can find.
Is this what your research assistants did? Hold the rock while you?
That's right, all day long. Yeah, look at that, Del.
Oh yeah, look
at
that.
At least three fish here.
Yeah.
So there's one there, one right there, another one there, another one there.
Oh my goodness.
That was a good break right there.
Yeah.
So these all look like Nydia. Just a little herring type fish. Boy, that one is a really nice one right there.
Yeah, it is.
Del, if you look at the edge right here, you can see multiple layers in here.
Yeah, I do.
And they're not very thick. They're almost as thick as playing cards.
Uh-huh.
And the conventional idea is that each pair of a layer, a dark layer and a light layer, lasted a year. But you look at fish like this guy down here, I do not see a single bone out of place. The fins are nice and splayed out right there. And based on my fish experiments, that thing sank down to the bottom of the lake and was buried in a calcium carbonate layer within a day after it laid down to the bottom. And I think that's the only way that you can explain such good preservation. And not only do we see it there, but that fish, and that fish, they all have really exceptional preservation, and they have to be buried quickly.
Yeah, there was really just a lot of fine detail in that fossil there. So those small, tiny layers that we're looking at here, those are not annual layers.
I don't see any way that they could be annual layers based on
daily.
How well the person, yeah, I would think almost daily layers mm-hmm. here.
Something was different about the water chemistry here in that it was precipitating a lot of this calcium carbonate out, which was covering the fish. The other thing that's really interesting about this particular outcrop is there's several volcanic ash beds in here. And so the volcanoes are nearby, maybe some of the ones up in Yellowstone. They would erupt, and the ash would settle down through the lake. And here's this nice orange layer right here. That would be one volcanic ash bed. Here's another orange layer, not as thick. That would be another one. Here's another volcanic ash right here. And here's another ash bed that's maybe an inch and a half thick.
Right.
These ash beds actually help us to tell time in the lake.
How's that?
If we can trace these ash beds and confidently know that they're the same from place to place in the lake basin, for example, we can look at this thickness between those two ash beds right there, and we know that that thickness of Green River formation was laid down at the same time, whether we're right here in this spot or over at the edge of the lake. And it happens that we know these aren't yearly events because you can find this ash bed here, count the layers, find it at the edge of the lake, and at the edge of the lake, the thickness is more.
Huh.
And so—
Is that more layers?
More layers at the edge of the lake. And that's because you have more sediments and whatnot coming in from the edge of the lake. And so we know these aren't yearly laminations. We know
make sense.
The laminations are not equal from here to there. There's about 30% more layers at the edge of the lake than there is in the middle. And I don't know exactly how much time is represented between those ash beds, but one thing I do know is that the time is the same, whether it be weeks, months, or years between those ash beds. I know that there's the same amount of time. And so I was able to study the fish and the decay of the fish and the preservation of the fish during the same time in the lake's history. So I think the take-home point is that the fossil fish and the other fossils here show that these sediments were laid down rapidly. Yes, it was after the flood, but even after the flood, we have processes that produce fast layers.
You know, John, one of the things that has really impressed me is that you're not content with just sitting in an office somewhere, but you want to be out here looking at the reality to understand the truth and the facts.
Yeah.
And I appreciate that about you, and that you understood you needed a PhD to help you do that. Is that important?
It is. At first I thought, you know, maybe why do I need a PhD? Why do I need to learn more? But the thing was that I didn't understand is how it would advance my thinking and how it would cause me to think deeper and consider other mm-hmm. possibilities.
So would you say that for a young person who is considering one of these scientific areas, that it would be important, number one, to get their doctorate, and it's important for them to understand there's a whole lot yeah. of things to be looking at?
I think, Del, there's two things that are really important for a young scientist. And number one is to become well-trained. You need to interact not only with other creation scientists, but you need to interact with conventional scientists too. But the other thing, Del, is they need to be grounded well in scripture. So they need to understand a biblical model, and they need to take things like this and put these kinds of things within the record. The biblical record doesn't tell us everything we want to know. It kind of gives us a framework. And we need the new generation to come up and begin to look deeper into some things. We don't know all the answers here yet. I would really like to know how much time is in between that ash bed and uh-huh. that ash bed.
Yeah.
And we need some new scientists out here that are trained to think well to work on problems like that.